For our COBT viewers, it's Maynard, Mike, and Jeff here with a fun guest, Derek Podhaizer. He's a good friend. He's an equity research analyst at Barclays. He's been doing it for over 10 years. He's just someone that we knew by reputation, and we were lucky enough to connect with him and convince him to join us on COBT. And lo and behold, there's a little bit going on in the OFS space this Tuesday. But Derek, seriously, we're so glad to have you. We've enjoyed getting to know you, and it's super fun to have you on the show.
Great. Good to be here, Maynard. Thanks for having me.
Well, it's going to be fun. Mike, there was a little news this morning, but what else you got before we jump
we'll
in
get
with
a little, we'll get to that news in a second. You know, it looks like a little bit of a wreck happening in the markets today, but we'll get to that in a second. I really want to hit on four subjects. First, economically. You saw the JOLTS jobs report came out a little hot today, and you had the ISM manufacturing come out yesterday a little hot. And so what we've had is the 10-year bond yield is up to around 4.35%. That's the highest year to date. And as you recall, most people expect the Fed's going to be lowering rates this year. And that's really calling the question if they're going to start lowering by June. And I kind of look at it and say, you know what? We're looking at, you know, energy prices are going up over the last few weeks. You're seeing basically economic stats are printing better. We've been talking about, you know, our power demand growth over the next couple of years. So we just see these cyclical and secular out, you know, inflation aspects out there. So I think this is going to be in question of whether the Fed is going to be raising or lowering in June, and if they're going to lower three times or less than that. My guess it's going to be on the lower end. So that's what the market's focused on right now. From a commodity standpoint, WTI is at $85 today. Brent's at $89 a barrel. The last time we were at these levels was in October of last year. The other thing that's we've been talking about for a while is just time spreads are just surging. We're in a steepest backwardation for WTI and Brent time spreads since June of 2022. And that's when WTI price was $120 a barrel. And so markets look physically tight right now. Tomorrow we're going to have OPEC's going to have their JMMC meeting that they usually do on a once or twice a quarter basis. They're going to have it tomorrow. Most people expect there's not going to be anything of substance coming out there. It's probably going to be pretty short, pretty consensus that they're going to continue to roll over rates into the second half of this year. Now, the thing I'd like to say about that meeting is that we have a really, really constructive setup for crude oil. Second half looks like it's in supply deficit if they hold off barrels. And so I think what we're going to see is a market where OPEC is going to have to push barrels into the market at some point next year. That is a much better look, much more constructive look than having to pull barrels off the market. I think that's what we're going to look at for then. As far as a broader equity markets, obviously the Dow's gotten down about 400 or 500 points today. A lot of it's just because rates are moving up because of the economic stats are challenging the thesis of lower rates, but also Tesla. Today, basically, their Q1 deliveries came in substantially below estimates. Year over year for Q1, it was down about 8.5%. That's the first time we've seen a down quarter for these guys year over year in a long time. And that just kind of shows you that the backdrop for EVs right now, demand is not as strong as people expect. We've been seeing this. We've been talking about it just because of rates and pricing and stuff, et cetera, et cetera. And if you look at the three or four, EV stocks that we kind of look at, they're down on average around 50% this year. So it's been a really ugly, ugly area for EVs. And so the last thing we really want to talk about is, today, and Derek's going to, we're going to talk a lot to him today about this, is, SLB acquires ChampionX in an all-stock merger deal, 14 to 15% premium. And we can talk a little bit about what that means. We saw them do a deal with Acker a couple of weeks ago. I think we're just going to see more consolidation. It's going to happen. The interesting thing to me is after they buy ChampionX, they're going to be about an $85 billion market cap company. The next closest market cap is Halliburton at $35 billion, so $50 billion bigger. I mean, so this is big heavyweight out there. And so, we just want to put that set up, and we want to talk about also the last thing we want to talk about is what oil service has done this year. Oil service is up around 10%. Land rig companies are up around 14 to 15% and pressure pumpers around, 7, 8, 9% this year. And so we really want to delve into, what Derek's thought process is with the frac companies issue, the land rig companies, and just the service sector in general. So with that, we'll hand it back over to you, Maynard.
Yeah. Awesome, Mike. Jeff, anything you'd throw in before we jump in with Derek?
I think we're about to jump in with Derek, but I think as a preview of of what we'll talk about, oilfield services spent so long, covering the sector. M&A in the sector is a lot different than the asset-oriented deals in either downstream or upstream. So people intensive, it's so facility intensive. It's hard. And so as we wade through this all today, I want to get Derek's perspective, not just from the financial market perspective, but just, you know, how it actually takes place. Yeah. And some of the difficulties we've observed in some of the other transactions that are ongoing right now.
Very interesting. Okay. Well, Derek, you know, we Mike said it around here today. It's like, wow, we felt lucky to get you and to get you on a day when there has been some dramatic news in the oilfield service space. The gods are shining on us. So we should just stop here and say thanks. But in all seriousness, maybe as a kickoff, your space, which is largely oilfield service, but you also have Ormat, you think a lot about geothermal through some of the covered companies, and you're obviously part of the bigger Barclays energy research platform. But tell us a little bit about life in your world right now, your stocks, the things you're covering, some of the things on investors' minds. Just give us a feel for your life right now.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's interesting. I think, you know, over the 10 years that I've covered this space, I mean, I joined my boss, Dave Anderson, 10 years ago, right before the fateful Saudi OPEC announcement, right before Thanksgiving, when they flooded the market and started the price war that really lasted, you know, 5 to 10 years. That was a cyclical boom bust that was live and die on growth. And we've seen a big transition among the energy services, the EMPs, to this nodal low growth environment, and really this demand from investors starting back at the end of 2018 around capital discipline. Started with the EMPs, it trickled down to the service companies, it really got accelerated through COVID in 2020. And then as we work through 2021 and transition year, we had 2022, the Russia-Ukraine conflict, and then we get into natural gas capitulation. It's how do these companies work, how do these stock works in an environment where consolidation is key, free cash flow generation is key, and primarily shareholder returns are key. So I find myself having those are the conversations around these companies where it's gone from, okay, boom, bust, how do I play those cycles as an investor? So now how do I think about these companies longer term through cycle, durability of earnings, and how does that translate into free cash flow and to returns, and what really makes these stocks work? So that's been a really interesting cultural change over the last 10 years for these stocks. And I think today's a perfect example of it. I mean, we've seen plenty of examples around consolidation. And I mean, that really got kicked off by the EMPs over the last several years, but primarily over the last year, we've seen some real big ones, obviously Exxon, Pioneer, Chevron, Hess, Diamondback, Endeavor, Oxy, Crown Rock. And that's trickled down to the service companies to also see that consolidation as well. And the biggest ones over the last year were Patterson and NexTier. We just had Atlas and Hi-Crush, obviously Drillquip and Innovex and now Schlumberger and ChampionX. And, you know, investors still want to see more. And I think we still will see more over the next year or so.
These deals that have happened, and you don't have to comment on particular deals, but just, you know, I think if you were using the upstream, you know, things tend to consolidate by basin, or they tend to consolidate with overlap. What's the thematic that drives a lot of the OFS consolidation? Is it, I would like to complement my suite of services, or is it like, what are the themes that people are looking for that they use to speculate on what may or may not happen in the space?
Yeah, we've seen a little bit of everything, but I think the most important thing is just supply rationalization. I mean, for my world, oilfield services just lives and die off of supply. So we talk about pressure pumping, right? Like that's probably the biggest one. We saw, you know, a lot of consolidation from ProFrac, which was good to tighten up the market from a supply side. And then we had Patterson and NexTier get together, which helped with that as well. And then the next iteration of that is the high grading piece of the equipment, moving into that 2 or 4 dual fuel engines or going straight into electric frac, which we're seeing as well. So I think we've seen a little bit of everything. It's around the supply side, the sand, proppant. I mean, Atlas taking down Hi-Crush, that brought together the two biggest players in the Permian in-basin sand market. And that really helps, because if you rationalize the supply, that keeps pricing supported, which creates earnings durability. And then you also had you know, more complementary deals done. I think today was a big complementary deal for Schlumberger, SLB, excuse me, where they get to expand more into the production side of things with Champion X. I mean, Champion X is one of the highest quality management teams, best execution companies that we've followed ever since they spun out of Dover years ago and were Apergy before they became Champion X. And that's SLB, seeing where the cycle's going, seeing upstream spending move more into OPEX versus CAPEX on the production. So you get the production chemicals, you get artificial lift. So we really see a little bit of everything. I mean, even Drillquip and Innovex, those are trying to expand services across land, offshore, international, and North America. So there's been a flavor of really everything, but at the end of the day, it's really trying to consolidate the supply base, be complementary. You know, we're also seeing companies try to get that international offshore exposure as well, which investors, they find that attractive.
That was interesting, that expression you used, you know, switching from CapEx to OpEx. And I guess if you reflect on SLB for a minute, they sold out of North American or lower 48 completions. And now they've moved into lower 48, you know, production chemicals. I don't want to be too simplistic, but that phrase seems to capture what you're talking about.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think, you know, one of the things that will come up with them is defending the North America, almost like reentering North America a bit for SLB, because the past was sand mines and, you know, old pressure pumping equipment, which the new CEO, Olivier, has done a really good job divesting from that and turning into more of a international focused, you know, drilling and production side, obviously offshore. But we know Champion X, we don't think there's any execution risk there. We thought it was one of the most high quality companies within our coverage. And I think most investors and other analysts feel the same way. So this is re-entering, you know, or not really re-entering, but expanding their presence in North America through a high quality player on the production side, which tends to have the longest tail, where you see all these wells, you know, primarily all the oil wells out there need some form of artificial lift. And that's where these guys come in along with the production chemicals. So it made a lot of sense to us, particularly that the OPEX is becoming a greater piece of the spending mix.
Well, and I don't want to do too many upstream analogies here today, but they are a little bit hard to resist. Sometimes when these smaller upstream companies merge with a larger company, you say, well, they kind of needed to do that to be relevant, or there's some of that language gets used, and not all the companies fit that that language. But is there a sense in OFS that some of these companies need to merge with bigger players in order to be relevant either to the customers or to the investors? Like, what is that discussion in the OFS space? Is there a necessity for these smaller companies? And, you know, Champion X was a really large company, so it's maybe not the best example, but what would you tell us about that?
Yeah, I agree with you. I don't think that's necessarily what Champion X did. I mean, they're pretty relevant. I think this was just, you know, the CEO Soma's way of, you know, getting as much value for his shareholders as he could, and this was the way to do it. What you're describing to me was the perfect example with what Patterson and Nexteer did. You know, at first you're like thinking, like, what's the crossover of drilling and pressure pumping? Patterson is pretty unique, having both services. Historically, Nexteer was that top tier one pressure pumping company, brings scale to the legacy Patterson business. And we're seeing, you know, those synergies become unlocked. But I think one of the main reasons behind that deal, and both management teams have said it, they just wanted to get bigger to be more relevant for investors, to be able to take bigger swings from a shareholder return standpoint, to take bigger swings from, you know, future M&A once they digest all of this. You know, maybe we'll get some more in the future, some bolt-ons. But you go from having $1.5 to $2 billion market cap companies to something more relevant in that $5 to $10 billion range. And I think that's a big hurdle for a lot of my space. I mean, you know, I'm more of the mid cap analyst, so I cover a lot of, you know, that $1 to $2 billion market cap company names, which is hard to get some investors to come down cap. I mean, some investors don't have the mandate to go down that low. They don't have the float, they don't have the liquidity. So if you can increase your size and scale through M&A and have crossover and synergies, and primarily through the lens of shareholder returns, both on and capital, you become more relevant to investors. And I think that's what was one of the main primary drivers behind Patterson and Nexteer. And I think that's going to be beneficial for the combined company over time.
So Jeff hit on a great point in the lead-in, which is integrating these people-intensive businesses. That's just a real challenge. It requires a lot of thought, a lot of town halls, you know, a lot of planning. There's just a ton that goes on there, not to mention the customers and how they fit into this whole thing. From a research perspective, do you look at some of these transactions and say, oh, well, that one probably has a better chance of integrating well or not as good chance? Or how do you assess that? Because that's so key to the realizing the value of the deal. How do you think about integration?
Yeah, no, I mean, it's a good question. It's obviously, since it's more like intangible, it's hard to really kind of measure that, you know, through an Excel file or something like that. But culture is really important. I think both management teams have to really buy in. Who's going to run the company? Who's going to, you know, respectfully bow out, right? Like to help drive synergies. So I think it's very important. I mean, I think you need to have that buy-in from that culture, from, you know, C-suite down to the guys out in the field. So it's something that we discuss. It's something that we talk about. And yeah, you need to see that. And I mean, I think there's a couple of examples, and maybe this is might be a better way to answer the question, is investor reaction. So if you think about Patterson Next Tier, I think people agreed with the combination, and I mean, throw Altera into the mix too. But some investors are like, wow, that's a lot to chew on in one time. You know, the stock might not perform well. Let's see if they can digest this and get through this. And for Patterson, it took two earnings cycles for them to show that, hey, we're not going to fall flat on our face. These synergies are real. We have line of sight or visibility on when we want to achieve these by the first quarter of 2025. And then start to see the stock work from there. But I think back to another really good example is actually when SLB divested OneStim to combine with Liberty back at the end of 2020. And that weighed a lot on Liberty for majority of 2021 as they integrated the OneStim employees, the OneStim equipment, a lot of high grading, a lot of rationalization. And then come 2022, when they said, hey, like, we got through this all, this is what we look like now. I mean, that stock was off to the races. It's really starting back then. So you kind of get a sense of how investors view this. They might agree with the deal rationale, but like, okay, let me hold off for a quarter or two to see how this is going to develop. Don't want to be there holding the bag if this thing falls flat on its face. You know, how big are some of the other shareholders? Are there lockup periods? Like, can I just buy off of that selling? So there's a lot of technical headwinds that can come with that. And I think that kind of all loops into that cultural integration. And but then once you're through it and we can see that synergies and we have runway to seeing those be achieved, then you start to get excited and the valuation becomes more compelling.
The OFS companies are so fascinating because they're really industrial companies with a lot of talented people who can do a lot of talented things. And that means strategically they can consider, they kind of have more flexibility to consider other ways to get involved with the broader energy value chain, you know, than say an E&P company or a power company or, you know, someone like that. What are you, you've been doing it a while. We talked about this since 2018, when, you know, the world did change and we started talking more about returns, but we also started talking more about other forms of energy, other ways to do things, other approaches. What would you tell us is going on in the sector that excites you? You know, what's under the hood that people wouldn't realize is actually going on in some of these companies? I mean, SLB, we had a research analyst from Evercore who was talking about, hey, that's an energy transition stock. It was kind of how he really framed it. But what would you tell us about all that?
Yeah, no, and I agree with that. I mean, they have the SLB New Energy Ventures, and there's some really cool, interesting things that they're doing. I mean, they just combined with the Aker carbon capture business as well. So you're seeing where that stock is going. I would say in my world, I think one of the most interesting things that we're seeing is really this power solutions business that's being spawned out. I mean, this is CNG delivery or straight field gas off, you know, off the wellhead. I mean, this is, you know, the biggest private player out there is like a VoltaGrid, who's been pretty public with some of their capital transactions. I mean, they're closely aligned with Halliburton for their EFRAC build out, which we know Halliburton is on the forefront of that. You know, they came out last quarter and talked about 40% of their fleets by the end of this year are going to be electric and 50% in 2025. And I think that'll just continue to march to 100% by the end of the decade. But most importantly, you need power generation. I mean, electric frac pumps are great, but they need to work. They need fuel. And that's where power generation come in, whether that's, you know, big 35 megawatt turbines or smaller 2.5-3 megawatt natural gas reciprocating engines. And to fuel those engines, you need gas logistics. And that's what we're seeing come out of Halliburton. Liberty's doing that with their Liberty Power Innovations business. NexTier built that organically with Power Solutions, which is now part of Patterson. And this is what's supporting their fleets that are running natural gas, whether it's dual fuel or electric. And that's part of this integration and bifurcated equipment mix, you know, particularly in pressure pumping, which is helping these pressure pumping companies. And this is why you're not seeing the earnings intense volatility that we have seen in the past when we lose 150 rigs or 60 frac fleets, that the earnings are actually remaining stable and pricing's really not going anywhere because of this high graded mix. And it really comes down to this natural gas burning equipment, which is non-fungible, it's bifurcated. It's not like it was in the past where everything was tier two diesel, all fungible and fragmented industry. And that's what gets me excited about, you know, pressure pumping is really because of this equipment mix. So that's one major thing that gets me excited is really around the power generation and fuel delivery that we're starting to see be part of these companies. And you touched on at the top. I'd say the other thing is, yeah, it's just the new energy sectors segment for all my companies. I mean, you know, Hallmark and Payne has 6 or so geothermal investments that they're doing. They're doing the drilling for Fervo Energy, which is probably the biggest, startup for the unconventional geothermal space, that geothermal anywhere, not necessarily the traditional geothermal companies like Ormat, who I cover. They're doing the drilling for them for their big 400 megawatt Cape Station, Utah power plant that they're building out that I think is coming online first power in 26 and complete in 28. Liberty's doing the frack for Fervo. This is actually fracking wells to unlock geothermal energy. You're seeing some bigger players like, you know, between Patterson, Devon, Chesapeake, they're all making investments in geothermal because it's a natural crossover. And you're still poking holes in the earth and you're extracting an energy resource, but instead of hydrocarbons, you're extracting heat. So I think that's the primary reason why I wanted to start covering Ormat, which I launched last year. And it's been fun to learn about that sector, different nomenclature, talking megawatt hours and capacity factors, a lot of different stuff that I'm used to in oil field services. But I think you're starting to see a lot of my companies go into that space and through the decade into next decade, I think it's going to become a bigger and bigger piece of it between geothermal and then that power generation side as well. You talk to Liberty, they said they'll do everything between data centers and disaster recovery. You know, dare not going to get into this too much, but dare I say AI, data centers, backup, you know, power generation, that's a whole different ball game. I think we're pretty far away from that from a services perspective, but that's something that you could potentially see because it's mobile power. And so long-winded answer of telling you that's what excites me right now.
Maybe to kind of piggyback on those thoughts. I mean, I look at your coverage and you seem to be more bullish, you know, pressure pumping companies as opposed to land rigs. I haven't heard you even say anything about land rig companies right now. And I guess my question is, you know, I would agree with you that, you know, these power solution businesses, dual fuel, the electrification out in the field is really taking the pressure pumping to a whole nother realm of business, it seems to me. Is that the case? And second of all, do you think investors see that case yet? Or are they willing to pay for it? Or is this something that's going to be, we're going to slowly have to, you know, drift into this? Because it doesn't seem like at 2.5, 3.5 multiples that people are really giving credit to these businesses being more stable, probably higher return businesses, and probably, you know, a bigger market segment they could go after. What are your thoughts there?
Yeah, I agree that North America re-rate story that we're all hoping and waiting on has not happened yet. Like you said, a lot of the pressure pumpers trade at 2.5, 3 times. The land drillers trading a little bit north of that. I think we're in a show me story where you got to prove it. And they have been proving it. They've been setting out goals and they've been executing on those goals between free cash flow generation and shareholder returns. Those free cash flow yields have turned out to be real. We've been seeing that. But I think when you just have natural headwinds of a rig count that's basically been flat for feels like the last 6 or 7 months. And then you have continued natural gas capitulation with gas below $2. And you have the big players like UT and Chesapeake, Southwestern, you know, and Terra all basically saying like, hey, we're going to cut rig count, you know, cut frac count, or just take a hold on and we'll wait and see till when the LNG export build out comes more into clear vision by the end of the year into next year, that's just always going to hold back the stocks. And I think until investors can get comfortable with what the floor and activity truly is, and once we see visibility into activity coming back primarily on the gas side, and as long as oil stays range bound into this, you know, nice 75 to 85 range that we find ourselves in, I think that's when we'll get the re-rate story happen, because at a certain point, it's hard to ignore mid-teens free cash flow yield and payout yields that are in high single digit, low double digit, where you look across different industrial sectors that they will attract a larger multiple for the same type of numbers that we're seeing, you know, returns on invested capital up in that high teens, 20% range. So I think it's going to come. You know, North America is just typically known as a short cycle volatile industry, but I think between all the E&P consolidation that we're seeing and the slow consolidation that we're seeing on the services side, that the numbers are going to speak for themselves, and it eventually will capture that re-rate story. I just think there's still this major headwind with the natural gas and what you talked about at the top of the call. You know, those barrels are going to be a deficit. We need to see barrels come back in the market. That's going to signal strength on the oil side, and then all of a sudden that we're going to get hopefully catch a bid on these North American names.
Maybe just a follow on to that question as well. Do you see sort of a bifurcated market happening in frac companies where the guys that have these power solution businesses, they're going to have a higher multiple, and the guys that don't, they're going to be just, you know, in a whole different segment, more of a commoditized type of multiple? What do you think about that? And do they have to have some consolidation in that area to compete?
I agree. I think we're going to see that. We've had a lot of good consolidation between the number of acquisitions ProFrac has made and then Next Tier and Patterson. I think there's still a couple mid-range fleet providers in that, you know, high single digits, maybe mid-teens area that could be acquisition candidates as well. But if I think back to 2017, this is always one of my favorite examples, that the top 75% of the horsepower is held by 10 to 12 players. And a lot of those players were large diversified service companies where frac wasn't their primary business. I mean, talking about the SLBs and, you know, the Weatherfords and Superiors of the past, right? But now fast forward to today, you have the top four or five names commanding 75% of the horsepower, and where frac is primarily their business with Halliburton, with Liberty, with Patterson, ProFrac, and ProPetra. And you go down to even further with RPC, Evolution Well Services on the private side, BJ on the private side. And a lot of this stuff is next generation equipment. And I think that's the bifurcation that we'll see. And not only just the equipment side going from tier two diesel to now this tier four dual fuel and electric, primarily with Halliburton jumping straight into electric, which I think is going to be prove out to be the right move over time. It's also integration. It's integration of services. It's not just showing up and fracking. It's showing up and running the logistics behind sand, running the trucking, running wireline, running chemicals, the power solutions we talked about. So it's tacking on more and more of those ancillary services to help give you a complete completion package and solution to the E&Ps. And when you layer the natural gas burning equipment, the most important thing is you're driving that total cost of ownership for the E&P down. We visited an electric frac site with Halliburton, Diamondback, and Voltigrade last month. And that's, you know, that was a big part of the conversation, the fact that it's an integrated solution between Halliburton and Voltigrade, providing that to Diamondback and being able to drive the cost down through efficiencies by pumping more hours per day and by delivering 100% natural gas and not having any diesel on site. While yes, the equipment is going to come at a premium, which is going to help Halliburton's business, it actually reduces the overall total cost of ownership for Diamondback, so they can show their investors that they're being more capital efficient on a per lateral foot basis. It's one of the very rare win-wins in the industry that we see between services and E&P. So just to circle back to your question, I think over time, yes, we will see multiples hopefully attached to those bifurcated services, and we are going to see this divergent with the top tier, both drilling and pressure pumping. And then some of the laggards are just going to stay behind just because they're going to be subscale and may not have that high quality equipment or complete integrated package.
And Derek, I wanted to zoom out a little bit, thinking over the longer term. If I go back over 20 years, in energy services, the recipe for creating value for investors was sufficient return on capital and then growing earnings per share. And so we have this backdrop where North America, as you let in, is pretty flattish. So as you think about, your coverage universe and energy services broadly, so we have the focus on returns and we have the earnings showing up as more durable, but there's not a lot of growth, or there's not going to be growth beyond, once you get everything kind of to the current pricing regime. So how do you think these companies, what's the path for them growing earnings per share?
It's not necessarily the primary motivator, I feel. I mean, when I started previewing 2024, I mean, I talked about how the activity outlook looked lethargic. And this was really before we got another wave of natural gas capitulation. And in the past, we would have seen these stocks collapsed. We would have seen investors discount that EBITDA per fleet was going to get cut in half and revenue per day was going to go from somewhere in the mid to high 30s down to into the high teens or low 20s. And we just don't see that because we have a newfound discipline. We have everybody staying in the line of capital discipline, holding on price. We don't have a big rush of supply coming into the market. I don't think a lot of these companies are focused on, hey, I need to grow for the sake of growth. I think that was primarily the old cycle mentality. It was a lot when private equity was a lot more involved in the sector, primarily the services. You talk to any one of these management team now, they all sing from the same song sheet. They're talking about driving shareholder returns and how much of a percentage of free cash flow can we give back to shareholders? What's our payout yield going to look like? And even though activity looks, flat at best from here on out, despite with what could happen with natural gas at the end of the year, but I'm not really counting on that. They're going to lean into their return programs. They're going to pay investors for holding their stock. You're going to see continued buybacks. All the programs are out there. You'll see moderate dividend growth, I'd assume, over time. And I think that's more the name of the game versus trying to drive, EPS or EBITDA growth over time. It's more about industrialization of services. It's through consolidation, low growth environment, how can we continue to generate a lot of cash flow, give that back to shareholders to be an attractive investment?
I mean, that makes a lot of sense, here in the near term, but I guess I struggle with, why would someone own a small cap, no growth, okay return story? So that it seems like the path to earning your driver's license to relevance, but I struggle with, a strategy being a couple through $2, $3, $4, $5 billion market cap that's not going to grow. Not for growth's sake, but grow earnings per share.
No, that's fair. And what you said an okay return story. Like, I wouldn't want that. You have to have a very robust, attractive return story, especially in slow growth. And that's where I think you're going to get the differentiation in some of these companies, the haves and the have nots. You're going to have to look for those types of companies that are going to outpace a flat environment through bolting on integrated services, like, for example, Liberty's LPI, Liberty Power Innovation. I mean, I had management on the road last year talking about that with a number of investors and saying how they grow that to be an equal leg of the stool in the next 7 to 10 years, right? Like, obviously, it's a very long ways away, but until we get there, you have to be able to keep investors' attention by having a nice, robust shareholder return program that is competitive in all the different indices, the S&P, the Russells, to be attractive. So I agree, like, if you're just going to be sitting there and not really growing and not have any sort of return story, it's going to be very tough for you to capture mind share from investors and to get investors to come down cap. So you really need to lean into that return story to be attractive in this flat environment that we're in today.
One question, which is the investor base and how it's been changing, the people that call you, I would guess, there was a period where the phone was not ringing, and then the phone started ringing some more, and now maybe it would surprise us where some of those phone calls are coming from. But what would you tell us about the investor community and the breadth of the interest, and just anything on the minds of the investors you talk to really every day?
Yeah, no, it's interesting. I would say it's really still a good mix of your hedge funds and then your big long only sticky money type investors, and still a lot of energy specialists out there that I have been speaking with for years. I think what does excite me is I would say some of the inbounds around, hey, can you share some primers, or hey, can we jump on the phone? Can you teach me about energy services, oil field services, or this is a new analyst to join firm XYZ and they need to get ramped up. Or maybe we pull somebody that was covering industrial material chemicals and now energy has popped up into their screen. Like, hey, tell me about this. And I think one of my favorite conversations that I've been having recently, primarily with land drilling, pressure pumping and proppant is, hey, I remember covering these names 5-7 years ago, super fragmented, super undisciplined. What's changed? Has it changed? They still look super cheap, but I hear that things are a little bit different. And it's like, okay, let me walk you through the last 5 to 7 years and talk to you how we've seen structural and fundamental changes in each one of these subsectors and why you can actually get yourself excited about it again. But I totally understand why you would come in with a little bit of skepticism, but you'll probably leave the conversation with being more intrigued. And that's what I find those are the conversations I find the most rewarding, is to try to help investors understand the last 5 to 7 years, what's really changed in North America services.
And the investors, in terms of what's on their menu, like how they tend to be organized, are they, I would have guessed historically they might have been, well, I do E&P and service. Maybe that's a grouping that you can choose on that menu. But then have investor menus been getting larger? Like you also cover Ormat, which does a renewable power, geothermal. You would call it a green stock or a clean energy stock. Like is the investor community frequently sampling the entire menu, or are they tending to stay, I either like classic or I like clean tech, but I don't mix and mingle?
That's a good way to put it. I do think it's sampling. I think there's, a bit of people are stretched thin, like I think you've seen that both on the buy side and the sell side, where, I can really speak for the sell side, where we've seen some of our peers exit or consolidate, right? It no longer is, I think Barclays is one of the last pure play service, vertical, I'd say, on the street, where a lot of our peers are covering E&P and services or midstream and services, or some, broader clean tech, industrial and services, which is obviously, an interesting way to do it, because you get a lot more perception across the market. But I think where we can find our niche, particularly me, and other folks on our team, is that we have these verticals and sub verticals where this is where we spend a lot of our time, and we can really help, be a resource for our investors to really know the space, because like you said, a lot of our investors really are sampling and have to really look at everything. And that's why they help or collaborate with us on trying to get up those learning curves when you have all these different nuanced granular issues going on or idiosyncratic themes going on in each one of these sub verticals. But I think that's a good way to put it, Maynard. I still think there is a bit of sampling across the different menus. It's not like you have, back in prior cycles, where it was, just a services book or just an E&P book or just a clean tech book. I think you're looking across the different sub verticals, which also helps you build your investment mosaic anyway. So I think it's helpful for, longer term as you look at really all the spaces.
So you mentioned Barclays and how it's organized. That was interesting. It also explains, honestly, before we met you, Derek, people would say, God, this guy's good. And I think one of those comments was because this is what you do. Like, you're very deep in this thing. You're not, a spread, perhaps, much broader. How is Barclays? Tell us a little bit about the research department, the changes, the global footprint. Do you guys get together once a week and debate all the energy stocks on the planet, or how does it work at Barclays?
Yeah, well, obviously give credit to the department at Barclays. They obviously foster a very good culture. Yes, we do have weekly energy calls where we're all, both on the US and the European side, get together, and our commodities analysts to talk theme stock along with our desk-based analysts. And I think you've just had a lot of people in the seat for a long time, including my boss, Dave Anderson. And I also have to give a shout out credit to Eddie Kim, who I've been in the trenches with for the last 10 years. And he is the offshore guy. So he's the one that's covering all the offshore during the offshore services name. And so he's just as deep as I am on the offshore side as I am on the onshore side. And that really gives credit to Dave, right? He's been able to give us the runway and the leashes to go off and do this, along with what management has allowed us to do, taking on this lead coverage, and has been able to give us the opportunity to start our own mini franchises. So definitely give a lot of kudos and credits there. But no, it's a good group, and we just re-upped on some different analysts, power utilities, E&Ps, great midstream analysts, a lot of good people across the pond as well in Europe. So we're a pretty complete team on the research side of Barclays, and which is exciting. It makes you excited to go to work and want to cover this space, and it's motivating. And it's good to know that our department has our back in order to do things like this and do our own corporate access and have our own events, field trips like we just did last month on our EFRAC tour. And we obviously have our big conference every September that we always try to get bigger and bigger. So we're definitely, supporting the energy vertical, which is good.
You know, one of the things that just dominated Sierra was, of course, AI, but the subtext was power. Mm-hmm. And where are we going to get all this power and data centers and all that? Is that something that is banging around inside of Barclays as well? And, you know, just that mania, I guess you might even call it at this point, everybody's excited about it.
Cautiously excited on the energy side, I would say, just because I don't want to get too far out over my skis, I think it's still going to be educating ourselves on where our names can fit in that ecosystem. Of course, in our semiconductors and software, they're all over that. We have a really good team over there. They've been talking about that. But, you know, I mentioned it a little bit before between, you know, what VoltaGrid's doing. There's a few other private third-party power as a service players out there. Another one is Amped, Accelerated Mobile Power. They're doing a lot of good things growth-wise. You have, obviously, Liberty with LPI. And I just wouldn't be surprised on seeing more and more of these power as a service companies come out. I mean, Ormat's has a hyper growth energy storage business. And I had a couple of management meetings with them a month ago when they were in New York, and that came up in a lot of our conversations as to how they can support, you know, the AI driven meaning that we're seeing as far as supporting those data centers because of the massive demand that those are going to command. So I do think that it is going to be a theme. It's going to be a growing theme. And I'm excited to see how my companies can participate in that and really what it means for the decade into next decade. And as they want to become diversified off of that more cyclical oil and gas market to become more steady power market, which comes with decade-long PPA as opposed to the North America service world, which is, you know, just you're lucky if you get multi-year contracts.
One question for you is, there's this backdrop around the North American conversation, particularly the lower 48 onshore conversation. There's this, usually this sense of like, well, it's maturing. It's starting to slow down. We're starting to see signs, things like that. But also, you know, there are the signs that we're thinking again about new ways to do things. We're thinking again about maybe there are some new areas or some of that tier two stuff might be better than that. How would you handicap the probability that we might have a new era? It doesn't have to be as big as the last one, but a new era of, you know, new techniques, new approaches, some new acreage, some new excitement, some new sizzle, because at some level it does look like the world would like that production. What do you think about a next round of technological advance in the lower 48?
Yeah, it's been pretty remarkable, particularly last year with the production efficiencies that we saw. I mean, I think if you will look at all the transcripts from the earnings call in 2022, it's all about well degradation. And then you get into 2023 and it's all about, wow, we're just nailing all these production efficiency records. And I think what you saw is you just saw a huge high grading of the equipment base and just higher quality service companies align themselves with the highest quality E&Ps. And if I think about, let's just start with land drilling. I mean, you got, you know, the big three, it's called H&P, Patterson and Nabors, you know, high grading a lot of the equipment base where you had a lot of those rigs come off. It's a lot of that legacy SCR mechanical rigs. You've had this super spec rig, these AC1500s, and now you can talk tier one, tier two super spec rigs with certain different clearance of the mast and walking systems. And I think at the end of the day, it's just, you just have better equipment out there and you have better software downhole where you're landing the drill bit, you know, earlier into the zone, which creates more frac stages. You can drill out 4 mile laterals. I mean, you heard that a lot from the Exxon Pioneer deal about drilling those extended laterals and having that production uplift from what they're going to be doing together. On the pressure pumping side, I mean, it's all about that higher equipment, higher quality equipment with tier four dual fuel electric frac. And you could just pump more hours per day with electric equipment than you can do with tier two diesel. That stuff basically turns on like a light switch and it just goes. And we're starting to see that. So I think between that high grading of equipment base and just reducing NPD and being able to keep that pumping time up for longer has really driven this huge wave of production efficiencies. And I think we're going to continue to see that happen. And look, that might reverse a little bit as activity comes back just naturally if we start to add more rigs and more frac crews. But we're seeing, I mean, this is just a pretty incredible industry, how they always seem to advance technology when you think you've hit the wall with production. I mean, we can only pump 24 hours a day, but you're seeing more and more of that happen over the entire fleet mix. And you're driving drilling times per day. And it's just remarkable to see that. And I think that what investors are worried about is that, does that have a deflationary effect on the service companies? Because maybe we only need 600 rigs, right? 600 to 650. We don't need to go back to 800 rigs. And we could have a frac fleet in the 250 to 300 range. And we don't need to go back to 350. But more importantly is these service companies are getting paid for unlocking those efficiencies by maintaining their pricing and expanding their free cash flow. I think that's the big offset from what I hear from investors that are worried about the deflationary effects that production efficiencies have. But as long as the service can rationalize the supply base and can keep up the discipline and command that premium pricing for the equipment that they're deploying out in the field, that's what makes it a compelling investment case. So no, I think you're right, man. I think we'll continue to see it go, because every time you think the industry is tapped out from a technological advancement standpoint, they find new ways to break ahead. So it's always fun to watch. There's always something new to learn every month, it feels like.
Yeah, speaking of technology, maybe switching gears and talk a little bit about geothermal. You know, obviously you mentioned earlier that you're covering Ormat. A few of your service companies are involved in geothermal as well. You know, at Sarah Conford, geothermal was a big, big topic there. And then I think 2 weeks ago, DOE just put out a big geothermal report. Mm-hmm. I guess my question is, I mean, we're not there from a cost standpoint, technology standpoint. A lot of people are getting into it. It feels like geothermal wasn't really talked about a year ago, much less 6 months ago. And now it seems to be a focus for a lot of people. And I see, you know, some of the benefits and advantages of it. Where do you think, and you know, first of all, what are your thoughts about that? And second of all, where are investors? Are investors inquiring right now about geothermal? Are they sensing that there could be something here? And how do you think this kind of unfolds over the next 4 or 5 years?
Yeah, it's fun to watch, you know, all the excitement and really hype around geothermal, because we're in this new age, whether you want to call it AGS or EGS. I just like to call it unconventional geothermal, because I think they're going to go through like a shale boom, just like we saw the oil and gas companies go through, you know, a couple of decades ago. But this was really a pet project for me that started when SLB came out with their new energies subsidiary, and geothermal was part of it. Because a lot of the guys, a lot of the big players have been providing geothermal consultancy or equipment to the geothermal industry for decades. But they started talking about it again because we had these startups really get spawned out of the oil and gas industry. I mean, Fervo is the perfect example. You know, Ever is the other one, the other big one that's out there as well. Then you have, you know, Quaid and a whole bunch of other ones, Sage Geosystems. Then where these folks are coming out of the oil and gas industry, they're using that same knowledge base, same technology to unlock geothermal anywhere. You're not just going to be confined by the Ring of Fire or the West Coast of the US, and you're going to be able to, you know, hopefully one day drill anywhere you want deep enough to unlock that heat. Obviously, it has to be at the right economics, and that's what everyone's trying to attack right now. But that was back in 2021, so I just kept my eye on it. I thought it was really intriguing. It was exciting. I started talking to some of these startups. There were some new conferences that started to pop up around Houston that I would go down to and just start to get into the market and meet everybody. And, you know, there's a big advocate like Jamie Beard out of University of Texas that's doing a lot with everything. There's geothermal rising. There's a whole bunch of folks out there that are really committed to the space. And it's really exciting to see. And then once the companies that I cover started getting it, primarily H&P and Neighbors were probably the two most vocal, followed by Liberty. And then it's like, okay, this is starting to become a real thing. And I think everyone's trying to attack this. And it's just a natural crossover industry for the services side. I mean, you're drilling a hole in the ground and you're fracking it to unlock heat beneath the surface, to spin a turbine and to create power generation. So it's exciting. Obviously, we need to get the cost down, but I think what a lot of the people at CERAWeek for geothermal, I'm sure they brought up, is they feel like they're basically where solar was 10 or 20 years ago and had to bring that down the cost curve. And I think being able to leverage a massive industry that is the whole energy value chain and leverage that technology and knowledge base, they're going to be able to do it, you know, over time. And to answer your other question, with Ormat, I've been covering them for about a year now, and it's been fun. I mean, it's been fun learning the new sector, fun learning on the new nomenclature. And I would say the inbounds have picked up pretty steadily over the last year. You know, people getting really excited about the fact that this is a non-intermittent power source. It's base load, it's flexible, it's dispatchable, and knowing how power generation and grid stability is probably going to be one of the biggest themes over the next several decades. Like, how do you play that? And, you know, for me, it's really Ormat, and Ormat's really only US publicly listed company out there. And I think over time, hopefully we get a few more that they'd be public, or we start seeing some of our service companies increase their exposure in the geothermal, along with other new energy spaces as well. And yeah, there's just more and more to look forward to. And frankly, just helps the terminal value of these companies and helps ease those concerns of some folks that might believe that, you know, peak oil is around the corner. But that's, you know, a whole different debate.
Derek, I wanted to turn back to, we talked about, you know, probably 30 minutes ago, market relevance. And so I know it's a topic that companies struggle with. So it'd be great to hear your perspective. You know, it seemed to be a moving target, you know, in terms of what establishes size, but is it investment grade? Is it a certain trading liquidity? Is it index participation? You know, how can a company think about, you know, what's needed to establish market relevance?
I think, it's a good question. I think it's all the above, to take the easy answer. I mean, I think you need to get to a certain, you know, market cap of it. Think back to the messages we have. Patterson last year, they were really focused on that $5 billion mark. I think they got a lot of feedback from investors that makes you relevant. You obviously have to have the volume coming through. I mean, I talk to a lot of, really down cap small companies, even some within my coverage, that, you know, I share their frustration as far as not being able to capture the mind share from investors. And I'm like, look, these are some of the indicators that I look at between market cap and, you know, average daily volume and liquidity. And you just are, if you're at this low level, we need to see this come up. And it sometimes becomes a circular reference between market cap valuation and earnings growth. But I think this also helps create an environment where we need to see more consolidation, because as these companies roll up and, you know, whether it's all stock or at least primarily stock and some cash, then that brings you up the cap structure, and that brings your liquidity up, and that makes you more relevant, because then you can have bigger swings as far as a shareholder return program. And that's how you start to get investors to be more interested, because frankly, when you look outside of services, even the E&Ps, I mean, the market caps just really shoot up. So it's just tough to capture that mind share. And I think they're doing a good job with it right now. And I think we just will need to continue to see events like we saw today and over the last couple of weeks continue to happen. And But yes, I think it all makes you more relevant as you start bringing up your market cap liquidity returns program, and that will help you capture more and more mind share from the investor base.
So, Derek, one question. So you have to your point there, there's a quote consolidating classic OFS industry, dynamic going on. If we were to start seeing, and I don't want to use specific names, even though I'm tempted, I won't. But how, if people start cutting across lines, if classic OFS starts buying clean tech, or if clean tech starts, merging into or acquiring classic OFS, like how do you see the development of hybrid animals playing out over time? And if you're a company, how do you think about how much of that will my shareholders let me do before they say, hey, what are you doing? You're outside your lane here. It seems like OFS, because they are basically industrial companies, they get a lot of leeway on where their skills can transfer. But I'm just curious how you think about that issue.
It's interesting. Hopefully over time that could happen. I think valuation might be a big hurdle. Obviously, where some of those clean tech companies trade versus some of our legacy service companies, where it might be too dilutive and investors are like, hey, I've been enjoying this great payout yield, this great free cash yield. What are you doing going and buy company XYZ in clean tech? You're spending all your free cash flow. You're not giving it back to me. But I think over time, as the cycle matures even more and we get to a certain point, say, okay, what's next? What's complementary? I think that's really important. And what makes sense from some sort of hybrid portfolio management where you're going to be able to drive both returns on and of capital, then investors might warm up to that idea. But right now, it would seem like a big hurdle to get over today.
Well, and you could get the, forgive the analogy, the AOL Time Warner effect, where the high multiple thing acquires the classic business to, who knows? We're getting carried away here, Derek. Okay. I have two really hard questions for you as we wrap up. One is, a lot of the jobs in this industry, they're great jobs. And I know you can't just, broad brush it here, but they're great jobs. They pay well. They're outdoor jobs. I mean, they are cool jobs, but a lot of them are also hard jobs. I mean, you're getting up at 3 a.m., they are physical, hard jobs. Can we find the people to do all these jobs? I mean, I think if my dad was here, he'd say, is this generation tough enough to do these jobs, Derek? But what do you hear about manpower, just people keeping teams together? What's your sense of things?
Yeah, no, and all credit to those men and women out there. I mean, when I went on location last month, it's like, wow, like I don't know if I could do this every single day, seeing them out there and, getting their hands dirty and basically keeping the lights on across the world. So it's pretty remarkable what they do. Yeah, I mean, look, that question comes up a lot. Your labor force, how tight is it? How hard is it to keep labor? I mean, I think if you talk to all these management teams, they'll always say that entry-level position they try to make attractive, particularly if you're trying to get somebody that is coming right out of high school, not going to college, and it could be a good way to earn a really good living and not have to go through the college ranks, but come just straight into industry. And then I think they've been doing it for so long that they have a method where they'll keep, one really good example comes up is what HP likes to talk about, their bump back program, is where they really hold on to their managers and to their, drilling directors that they can't lose. So they make sure they take care of them. But in times of, downturn, if you want to call it, you do a bump back, you move them back, you let kind of the lower tier go. And then once you start to see growth again, you bring them back and you bring back the lower tier, but you're able to plug and play that lower tier. As long as you have the right management in place, you don't have those same growing pains that you would if you try to just let everybody go and bring everybody back over and over again, that I think the industry saw in prior cycles. So look, I share the same sentiment. I don't I'm not too close to it as far as the labor force, you know, down in the in West Texas, but I hope that that industry continues to make it attractive for people to go in, because it's obviously an industry that they need. And we'll continue to hopefully see it flourish over the long term.
Well, you're right. And we should, we have one of our favorite things is we do a Thanksgiving show and usually try to find people working in the field, working hard. So this is a great place to pause again and say thank you to everyone who is working so hard. And I'm sure I couldn't do it. You got a shot, Derek. You're still young, but although maybe I could. Okay, last question, really hard one. The state of the energy transition. And I know that's like ridiculous to ask you that, but what I mean is you see it every day. You hear from investors. You know what questions they're asking. You see your whole team. You see the stocks that are up, the stocks that are down. You hear what the clean energy team is talking about. You see what the classic team is talking about. It seems like the mood at CERA was some sort of, sober was, I think, what we kept kind of feeling like this. Hey, we need to slow down. We need to think about everything that's happening here. How do you think about where we are in that whole discussion? Because it's been a roller coaster. And it depends on who you're talking to as to what you think of the state of things are. But how do you think about that big gnarly question right now? Like where are we? Where have we evolved to? You're also up in New York City, which is not necessarily oil and gas country. So you may have a better perspective on some of those opinions. But anyway, what would you tell us?
Yeah, no, it's good. And I like that you use the term sober. So to quote, you know, Chris Wright, CEO of Liberty, he likes to talk about energy sobriety. And I'm sure you guys have all heard him on what he's been very vocal, you know, between him and like Toby Rice of EQT. I mean, I'll leave it to those guys. Those are like the guys that are in the know that know what they're talking about. But I guess just from my own perspective, I agree with you. It's been a roller coaster. I think it was, you know, spawning out of the COVID timeframe when demand was down so much that it was very easy to talk about a very quick energy transition. I think once we came out of the COVID downturn and people wanted to start going back to some sort of normalcy, and we saw what that did to demand, that people have rethought what energy transition mean. I mean, I think, look, it's going to happen, right? And I think a lot of our companies are involved, and I think they just want to do it in a very methodical, smart way. You can't just, you know, turn a light switch and all of a sudden become a, you know, completely on the other side of the energy transition. So I think it just has to be strategic. It has to be methodical, has to be thought out, because you have to make sure that it's fair to really everybody across the globe. And I think we'll get there, and I think we'll get there over time. But I don't think that, you know, oil and gas is obviously not going away. But does it become a lower part of the mix? Maybe. But I think the technology really needs to continue to develop really across all different verticals, you know, solar, wind, hydro, geothermal, lithium, carbon capture, really, you know, kind of that all-in mentality that a lot of folks talk about. You know, if you want energy transition, energy additive. I mean, I know I've heard all the different terms that have been thrown out around there. So that's kind of how I feel about it too. Just, you know, you're hearing all the different CEOs across oil and gas, between what we see domestically and what we see internationally as well, talking about their views on it. And I think it all has a common theme of being more sober about it and being methodical and being strategic about it to do it in an orderly fashion way.
And so you mentioned, Chris, you know, Liberty puts out that incredible report called Bettering Human Lives. Does that register with investors? Does that become part of why you do or do not buy Liberty, or do they just view that as extremely informative and tells them a lot of great information, but it's sort of separate from the analysis? I'm just kind of curious, in the investor mindset, how does a report like that affect them?
I would say the latter. Obviously, very impressive what Chris and his team do with that report, but I wouldn't say it's the primary driver of, you know, their stock performance or really the entire space's performance. You know, you can even say the same argument about emission standards and what people are reporting for scope 1, 2, and 3. I think over time that is going to matter. I just don't think it's not the primary driver. Like obviously it does matter, but it's not the primary driver today. But no, I would agree with you that it's more on the latter, that super informative, very helpful. They always provide a whole bunch of really interesting data points in there that I've pulled out and have used. But for right now, not the primary driver, I would say in the for them specifically, then for just the broader industry as well.
Well, Derek, we hate to let you go. This has been a lot of fun. Mike was literally on the edge of his chair. He had so many more questions today, but we really appreciate you joining and sharing your thoughts. And, you know, please come see us in Houston. We're excited for you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks for having me. Yeah. I'll definitely come down and see you guys.
Awesome. Thanks, everybody.